Our next speaker is Eran Sela. He's coming from physics. He will talk about Majorana fermions in nanostructures for quantum computation.
Okay, so yeah, let me thank the organizers for the invitation. So it's actually my first time in this kind of nano conference. And when I was preparing the talk, I was not sure to whom I'm going to talk about. And the question that I was asking myself is, for example, why should a biologist care about Majorana fermions? And well, I will be very basic and try to argue why this whole topic is interesting. Without getting too much actually into my own work. So I'm part of the low temperature condensed matter physics groups in Tel Aviv. So I do theory. So what are the general kind of questions that we have in mind are about understanding phases of matter specifically. So what we try to understand is understand behavior of many particles which are typically governed at low temperatures due to quantum effects. So as Phil Anderson put it, more is different. So although we do understand the basic particles, in this case, for example, electrons and protons, there is many surprises in terms of many body phases. So superconductivity and more exotic states that I will discuss. And also there will be interesting devices and applications that we can use our knowledge for. So to convince you that actually this is closely related to nanoscience, actually our theoretical input goes hand in hand with experiment on the nanoscale. So for example, here you can see a simple experiment which is typical in my studies. For example, you are driving an electronic current in a two-dimensional surface where there is this gates which create a narrow constriction. So you pass current from bottom to top, whereas this there is a constriction of below 1 micron size. And you basically just measure the current as a function of the voltage difference, so the conductance G. And you can measure this as a function of a gate voltage that we can easily control, and which basically opens this constriction. So we expect the conductance of this constriction for electron motion to grow. But we can clearly see in this experiment that it does grow, but in steps. This immediately tells us that electrons behave very much like photons, which was a topic of the last talks. So actually, electrons are waves, according to quantum mechanics, indeed. And there is a quantization of their transverse motion with respect to this gate. And the unit of conductance here is E squared divided by H, where H is Planck constant, and E is the electron charge. And this is basically 1 over 12 kilo ohm. So so the story that I would like to tell you today, as I mentioned, is about Majorana fermions. And to go closer to that, let me give you another simple setup that we like to study. For example, graphene. So you take a bunch of carbon atoms, and they like to form many structures, for example, two-dimensional honeycomb. And then you take this two-dimensional honeycomb structure and measure here all kind of properties, for example, conductance. So why I'm telling you about graphene, so when you look at the electronic structure of this material, so the energy E of K versus momentum, you discover that it is very strange. Actually, the energy versus momentum, it looks linear as opposed to quadratic. And this actually goes back to the early days of quantum mechanics, where Paul Dirac actually, for the first time, wrote an equation that puts together two things, quantum mechanics and also relativity, Einstein's relativity. And he discovered that, you know, that only at very low energy, electron has quadratic dispersion relation. However, at high energy, it will have linear dispersion. So this should describe relativistic electrons, very high energy. However, what I'm telling you is that in this material, actually, effectively, the system behaved just in the same way as predicted very long time ago by Dirac. So these are electrons in graphene behave like Dirac electrons. Now, the theory of Dirac actually contains another important, actually, it has many important predictions, all of which were confirmed. But another one is that the electron is one of the solutions to his equation, which I denote by letter psi. But then there, if you think of psi like a complex function, so there is always a complex conjugation of this solution. And actually, it corresponds to another particle. This psi dagger, or psi star, is actually a friend of the electron, which is actually its antiparticle. So actually, Dirac discovered that there is an antiparticle for each particle. And it was indeed seen. We call it positron. However, at some point of time, Ettore Majorana, an Italian physicist who has an interesting story, he actually disappeared during a boat trip between Napoli and Palermo. Nobody knows exactly what happened with him. But he looked at just based on mathematical elegancy on the equations of Dirac and say that he can find the solutions which are real in the sense that if you take Hermitian conjugation, you get the same solution, which means a particle which is the same thing as its own antiparticle. So since I'm going to discuss this and it's why it is useful for us, so just to think what is a particle, antiparticle, and Majorana fermion, you can think of a glass with wine. So a particle is like a glass filled with wine. The antiparticle is on the left, an empty glass. So what would be a particle which is the same thing as its own antiparticle? So it's exactly half-filled glass. So anyway, do we have such particles in nature? So actually, when you take particle to its antiparticle, many things reverse, like it's an electronic charge. So it has to be charged neutral, for example. And this is why it interacts very weakly with almost everything that we know. So this is why these particles, if exist, they can penetrate Earth, basically. So there are very large-scale experiments looking for those particles, for example, in Dakota mines. But the reason that I put this picture here is to say that we currently are doing an experiment and discovering new things about Majorana fermions in very small scale, so nanoscale experiments, basically using nanowires, as I will describe. So, people from my group, some of them is listed here. I'm discussing mainly work by my PhD student, Aviad Landau. So why would these Majorana fermions be useful for anything? So this brings me to the second part of the title, quantum computation. So each computer is built of basic bits where you store information, zero or one, and a quantum computer is simply a situation where each bit is a linear superposition of zero and one. So if zero and one is up and down, then you can have also spin along x direction, which is equal superposition of up and down. And actually, serious companies in the world like IBM and Microsoft have their sections working on designing of quantum computers, mainly based on superconducting qubits, which is not what I will discuss. I will discuss some analog way to do quantum computation with Majorana fermions, And I'll tell you why this is useful. I mean, why Majorana fermions are useful for this purpose. So if you take any qubit, any, so forget the word boson, please, here. So any qubit which is, you can think of it like a spin. So up and down is like the two states of my bit. The problem, the main problem with quantum computation is that these qubits are extremely fragile. So you can, there is the environment, either if you put the qubit inside a material, so there is vibrations or electromagnetic waves, which will couple to our qubit degree of freedom via this Hamiltonian, doesn't matter exactly, and this will lead to two effects. One of them is bit flip, which is a drastic effect of taking the state zero and making it one. There is another effect of just phase, changing the phase of the qubit. Because it's a quantum state, it also has a relative phase between the two up and down or zero and one states. So what is the advantage of working out with fermions? So actually, what is a fermion? So in physics, we have two kinds of particles, bosons and fermions. So basically, bosons like each other, whereas fermions hate each other. So two fermions, like two electrons, cannot be placed in the same point in space. Or if I have just a single level of some atom, like this line here, so I can put in this level only either nothing or one electron, but not two. So people plan to use such levels of some sort and the two states of not occupied or occupied as a qubit, degree of freedom. And this is very useful because of a law of nature, so a physical law of nature, which is the conservation of the number of fermions or the parity of the number of fermions, or even or odd. There are no processes that change the number of fermions in nature. So this qubit does not suffer from bit flips. However, it can suffer from phase noise. And now, forget all the equations, but basically comes the part of where Majorana fermions can be useful. So each, as I said, from going from Dirac fermion to Majorana, so each fermion is like a complex number which has two real components. So each fermionic level is essentially composed of two Majorana states. It's mathematically identical, and the coupling to the environment, this H, is basically coupling between the two Majorana components, gamma 1 times gamma 2. Now, if we could do make one fermion, which is composed of two fermions, so Majoranas, very far apart, gamma 1 and gamma 2, then the coupling between them will be exponentially small, and then we will have a qubit which is perfectly protected. So it turns out that we can do this nowadays using physics, which have become now very popular, of topological insulators. So let me mention just what is the basic idea of how to get Majorana fermions detached from each other, but in a very simple and cartoonish way. So imagine, take a lattice, a simple model for a lattice of of where electrons propagate, and this is just a one-dimensional cartoon of a crystal, okay? And I'm considering a model which is a textbook problem that we give to our students to solve. So you have two atoms per unit cell, A and B, and there is couplings between atoms, for example, T1 and T2, and then it repeats itself. So if you look at the energy E versus momenta K of this model, it will have two bands and an energy gap between them. And so this is the exercise that we give to the students to get the bands. But now if you look at the electronic density, where exactly the electronic density is located, so actually this depends on which coupling is larger than the other. So if, for example, in this picture, T1 is larger than T2, so the electrons are mainly localized in the links between atoms A and B, let's say on the same unit cell. Now, I can have two situations now. Now I'm comparing two situations where all that I'm They look almost identical, but I just change which kind of dimerization pattern occurs. And these two situations are consistent with having some inversion symmetry around the center of dimers. And in both situations, you will just find the same energy bands in the bulk of this material with an energy gap. However, the second situation is called the topological insulator, and this is why, because as long as you have a boundary of this system, then you will have an edge state. And you can see that immediately that there will be one electronic wave function, which is consists of the two ends of this chain. So in general, topological insulators are insulators in the bulk, which necessarily have edge states. So for example, people have recently grown quantum wells, so cadmium telluride and then mercury telluride and back cadmium telluride semiconductors. And it turns out that right at this quantum well, only at its boundary, there will be counterpropagating edge modes. There are similar three-dimensional materials which have the same phenomenology, and we have experiments that can probe those edge states. And now the role of now going back to our aim, we wanted to have these exotic particles predicted by Ettore Majorana. So this, I would like to claim, has to do with superconductivity now, and I will tell you why. Take aluminum, for example, below a certain temperature, for example, 3 Kelvin for aluminum, 1 Kelvin, the resistance drops to zero. Below this temperature, really what happens is that electrons pair into Cooper pairs with opposite spin. And now this situation is ideal for having Majorana fermions, as I will explain in the following slide. So first of all, in the left picture here, I'm forgetting about superconductivity and just explaining that actually in condensed matter, actually this concept of particles and antiparticles is very useful and makes full sense. So in condensed matter, we have we have a Fermi C. This is why, because electrons are fermions, which is filled by electron states and empty above this energy level. And we have two kinds of excitations, particles above this Fermi C, but also holes, which is like bubbles of missing electrons inside the Fermi C. Holes are positively charged as opposed to electrons. So now that in a conventional semiconductor or insulator, particles and holes are distinct particles. However, in a superconductor, there is no clear distinction between them. If you take here electron, which is blue, and the hole, which is green, you can convert from one to the other. Because if you have in a superconductor now a collection of Cooper pairs, which is in a condensed state, so you can take, for example, a hole, which is positively charged, together with a Cooper pair, which is doubly negatively charged, and actually convert it into one electron. So what has been found is that actually, if you take superconductors with these properties, so strong spin-orbit coupling, this is the most important feature, and couple it, then you will have this exotic situation with Majorana fermion excitations. And the experiments that have seen this, and which give a lot of hope to use it for applications, are these two. So here on top, you can see a nanowire, which is made of indium arsenide, for example, and it's just placed on top of some superconductor like aluminum, and you just measure in some way the conductance into the ends of the wire, and what you can see are peaks in the conductance, and these peaks stem from the fact that Majorana fermion in a superconductor allow a single charge E to tunnel into the superconductor. Okay, so basically, after all this long introduction, and how much time do I have?
You have about 5 minutes.
So I can tell you what are the main questions that people are trying to answer and what I am doing. So the question is now that we believe that we have seen these exotic particles in simple condensed matter setups is actually how to control them and seriously do something with them. So what we are proposing, and experiments are already going to this direction, is to use now Coulomb interaction in nano devices. So basically, we are looking now at physics at Majorana Islands. So this goes back again to something very simple and common in terms of experiments that people do, which is quantum dots. So what is a quantum dot? Again, we just as in the previous example where I passed current in a two-dimensional electron system, now I do the same thing. I would like to pass current in that picture from left to the right, but then I have two constrictions made by Gates, and I need to pass the current through this small island. Now, when this island is small enough and sufficiently where the resistance is sufficiently large, so charging effects inside the island will become dominant, and electrons will not be able to penetrate into this region just because of single electron repulsion. So as a result, when you increase, for example, change, when you measure the current, you will just measure zero. However, if you are able to change the gate voltage, so basically you can attract electrons into this island, and in this way, as a function of the gate voltage, you will see peaks in the conductance. And this guy tells you exactly that electrons tunnel into this island one by one. So what you can do is actually, this was actually one of the, I think, a very interesting projects, is to discuss these peaks of conductance, but in the case that you have superconductors of this type, and it leads to very interesting features. So a peak with actually exactly fractional conductance, which have a deep reason, which I am not explaining, but I think it will be closely measured. Here is the first experiment that looked at this kind of a conductance via islands with Majorana fermions. It is one wire of length of half micron, more or less, which is actually tunnel coupled to two leads. And what they have measured is just the conductance, which is plotted in that figure, as a function of the gate voltage. And what you can see is precisely peaks signaling entering of one of extra charges into the island. And this experiment is consistent with basically theoretical expectation. And the second thing that I would just like to mention is our attempts to bring this to a useful situation for quantum computation. So so let's see. So we are suggesting such a setup, which is composed of many islands. So what you can see here in A is just one Majorana fermion. Now B is the basic, so A is just one Majorana bound state, which is obtained in one wire, as I mentioned. Then in B, you have two wires inside one island, which means that all these Majorana fermions are going to interact via Coulomb interaction. And when you couple few of those islands, which we call Majorana Cooper boxes, actually in this way, you get now many body states of those Majorana fermions, and these guys are going to be very, they can simulate precisely what people have been doing for example, Microsoft, but using Majorana fermions, and we have a very clear prediction how to so perform measurements on these qubits and how to manipulate them via electronic nanoscale conductance measurements. And I think that I'll just summarize here. So the take-home message is that we have here state-of-the-art nanotechnology allows us now to combine interesting effects of superconductivity, now also topology and charging, to obtain new states of matter and with possible near-future applications. Thank you.
Thank you. The session is open for questions.
Any questions? Yes.
Okay.
The steps that you described in conductivity resemble a lot to what was called, or still is called, colonic brocade. Is there any difference between that and what you described as Mariana state?
So this this is called. So these peaks are called Coulomb blockade peaks precisely. This is exactly the same thing, yes, which basically is the reason for calling this a single electron transistor.
Yeah, but that's just due to simple Coulomb.
That's right, but.
Charging and capacitance of whatever.
Perfect. But then I'm telling you that so there are two further steps. If you take if the island is made superconducting, and this is an old experiment, then the peaks will be doubled, because in superconductors we cannot enter single electrons, but rather pairs. However, if you have now what I call topological superconductor, then, which is this experiment, then you can see here that the peaks from two periodicity to one periodicity. If you can drive the system to this topological superconducting state. So we play the same games, but we see new physics.
Okay, other questions? If not, thanks to the speaker again.
Thank you.